to support and control. It's not a that easy job to control 130 crore plus population. And we have seen the Europe and American countries, they are also struggling, and they are also, we must compliment the government and our prime minister that under his leadership, by and large, as compared to the other countries in the world, we have been in much, much, much better position in this pandemic is concerned. Anyway, that is one part of it. That is not a subject of the day. But it has got an effect to some extent on our profession also. All of us may not be having the offices and houses close to each other, including the staff member. So many of you are having shortage of staff, limited people available, working from virtual mode, from home, et cetera, et cetera. Even the department is concerned, they are also by and large on the virtual mode. No physical hearings are being permitted, at least in the service tax and the GST part is concerned. So in this situation, the things are not as comfortable. For years together, we have been used to meet each other or during the hearing or maybe to clients on a face-to-face meeting was we are used to. Suddenly changing the mode, it's not that comfortable, especially to a people like me who are not reasonably well-versed with the technology. It's not that easy. Secondly, the notices have come in bulk. The dates have been extended by the government considering the pandemic. For issuing the notices, and the deadline was ultimately 31st December. So plethora of notices under the service tax considering the time barring were received in the month of December with a response time of 30 days mentioned in the notice. In my today's talk, what I have thought of is, let us explain first the provisions related to the show cause notices under the service tax regime. And then what are the powers of the executives or the officers? What as our professional and as a client, what is our duties, responsibilities, and the liabilities in this scenario, and how one should tackle it? That will be the focus. I have selected some case studies, maybe 8 to 10 case studies, based on my personal experience, the notices which we are handling, in what scenario we got a notice based on certain facts. And in that scenario, how to tackle, I'll be giving my views. Of course, it will be very difficult for, standardize this approach because the facts may differ from person to person. I have seen a lot of frustrations amongst the chartered accountant, a lot of deadlines all coming together, extension. What is happening, really speaking, is very difficult to justify if you are practicing in multiple area, one and income tax, company law, service tax, GST, then lots of amendment. So, we are running from pillar to post, no clue, and a lot of frustration. I personally feel it's a time that we have to understand there are two things on the priority of the government is concerned. On one end, they don't want to increase the litigation. That's why various schemes have been announced by them in last 1 or 2 years. To resolve, we have got a scheme under income tax, service tax. But unfortunately, on the other end, the way the notices have been sent, it is adding up the more litigation as compared to what getting closed in these schemes. So I think that needs to be looked in by the government, that it's a good idea to reduce the backlog of the litigation in the courts and tribunal. That's really appreciable. But one also has to see that the new litigation at the same pace or a double the pace, if it is being carried on or rather it is being generated, then there is no end to the story. That government need to understand the institute. And this type of notices, which we have seen, is no exception to it. It will add up to the more litigation. I personally feel the tribunal in service tax will be busy at least for next 5 to 7 years. Looking at the number of notices, what will happen to GST, God knows, because GST tribunal as on today is not yet formed. And in spite, there being multiple litigations over there. So government on one end has this drive. Secondly, the government is also trying to meet the targets on the tax collections. And in that process, they are making the executives, are making the taxpayers, even the professional as a target. Which is a very, very, not a comfortable situation, and which is something which is unjust to that extent, but going into the nitty-gritties, what I feel is we need to keep balance of our mind and try to look into what is the role of chartered accountant as a professional to support in this tough time to our clients from the draconian approach of the government at this juncture. So the idea is to give guidance in today's meeting. So let's proceed with this. In my presentation, the few of the slides are concerned, initially we'll be dealing with the provisions related to these notices, and thereafter I'll be taking you through the case studies, and I'm sure at least half an hour will be there for interaction of the issues and queries. Alpesh has already announced that let us stick to the topic of service tax rather going or diverting the topic. With this, I'll be proceeding with the presentation for today. Keys for handling service tax notices is the topic of the day. The first is one has to understand that these are a bit basic one or two slides for the reason that what I found is since many of the clients have been referred by chartered accountants to us who are my friends or the fellow members, what I personally find is that many of the chartered accountants, rather most I will say, have exposure on the direct tax. Direct tax and indirect tax, it's like the word tax is common, but the approach, the powers, duties, and the way the department is administering is completely different. I can put you this way, in a sense that there is a ball, you can play as a volleyball, and with the same ball you can play football. The rules, ground rules, realities, everything is different, only ball is common. The same way cricket or long tennis. The same thing is over here. The taxes are common, but approach is completely different. That one has to understand. Many of our dear friends have exposure to the direct tax, and they are used to the compliance, then assessments, appeals, etc., etc. in the direct tax regime. Friends, this is completely U-turn or a different approach you require under indirect tax. And absolutely, that is what is where it is very important. I thought, let me explain the major difference coming up between adjudication and assessment. Now, indirect taxes, especially when I speak about, tell about indirect taxes, please keep in mind, I'm speaking only service tax. We have nothing to do with GST in this today's talk. So adjudication is something which is being provided in a service tax that through Finance Act. What is mean by adjudication? Now, there is no definition of adjudication in the statute, in either excise or a service tax, Finance Act. But under common parlance, adjudication means it's a legal process by which the arbiter or judge reviews evidence and argumentations, including legal reasoning set forth by the opposing party or the litigant, to come to a decision which determines rights and obligation between the parties involved. Now see, very, very important. It's a legal process and which is reviewed based on the evidence and the argumentation, and very important, legal reasoning set forth by the parties based on that, what is the right and duties. So this is what a Wikipedia meaning, another meaning from Cambridge, means the act of judging the case, competition or argument or making a formal decision about something. Now this is what the adjudication means in nutshell. On the other end, the term assessment is concerned. There is no concept of assessment directly in the service tax, but in the assessment is concerned, in central excise it was defined in relevant rule 2B. That is, definition is assessment includes self-assessments of duty made by the assessee under rule 6 and provisional assessment under rule 7. Similar provisions are there under service tax, the section 72 of the Finance Act, and which says that there is a best judgment assessment or there was a provisional assessment. But very important, we are used to the assessment on an income tax, that you are aware that there are various mode. We have 148 reassessment, 147, then you have 143, 13, which is followed by the notices, the time limit, and the various provisions related to assessments are categorically being prescribed in the income tax. I'm sure most of us are used to it. Now, as you are the service tax is concerned, the relevant provisions are, first, let us go, what is the section 70, which is very important, that filing of the returns. In the service tax, section 70 provides that every person to assess the tax liability on the services provided by them and file the return in a prescribed form and manner. This is section 70, which deals with the filing of return. So that means the responsibility is casted on assessee to compute his tax liability and declare the same in the prescribed form by an S3 return those days. So it is a concept of self-assessment by and large. Because if you at the end of ST3 form, there is a declaration that I have computed my tax liability and I have paid it along with the interest, that is already there. Now, as against that, there is one more provision, and which is the provisional assessment, which was there in Rule 6 of the service tax rule, that will have a limited applicability only in the case where assessee is not able to determine his tax liability owing to various reasons, maybe valuation, classification, etc., etc., then he can go and opt for the resort to these provisional assessment provisions. These were the simple provisions related to the assessments or filing of the returns. So by and large, concept of self-assessment in the service tax. Now, there is one more important provision in service tax section 72, and which was about the best judgment assessment. The best judgment assessment is possible only in two cases. That if a person who is liable to file the ST return, this section you must understand, because show cause notices, many of which have been issued, in which we found that the best judgment has been done. If you read the show cause in properly, there is a section 72 have been invoked in many of the show cause notices. Now, if 72 can be invoked, if a person liable to pay service tax fails to furnish the return. So if you fail to furnish the return, this one provision can be invoked, or having filed the return, fails to correctly assess the tax. So either you have filed the return or not filed the return. If you have not filed the return, that can be invoked. But if you have filed the return, then the department or the officers feel that it is not filed correctly, there is some lacuna or leakages of revenue, then this section can be invoked. Now the CEO can make assessment of the tax liability, but very important, after obtaining requisite accounts, documents, books, or other relevant material as made available to him. See, the officer is concerned, he has to do best judgment assessment based on the detailed material made available. This is very, very important. That you must have seen that department of late in these current show cause notices, I have never seen the way show cause notices have been issued in for the collection of service tax in past when the law was operative those days, or even during the financial year 17, 18, 18, 19 or so, barring last 2 months or so, the show causes have come without going through the proper procedure. And that here also, it is the officer who is supposed to collect the details which is required for him to do the best judgment or allege in the show cause notice. Now, very important one more thing is, in every show cause notice for adjudication, the principle of natural justice should be followed. So before resorting to a best judgment also, or maybe the adjudication, the central excise officer to provide opportunity of being heard. These are the provisions in the statute for the purpose of service tax. Now, so in nutshell now, what is the difference between adjudication and assessment? In the service tax, the concept of self-assessment is there and more of adjudication. As against that, in direct taxes, there is everything is assessment and thereafter followed by appeals, etc. So in the adjudication process, what is involved? First, there has to be notice to specific person. So this is very, very important. If you have a notice, if your tax liability which is due or you've sought to recover from partnership firm, you can't issue notice to partners. So like that, it has to be a specific person. Not only specific person, if one person has got multiple service tax number, then the notice should be given to a specific service tax number holder only, the whom issued. These are the cases which we are facing right now. Then there has to be specific allegation. It has to be alleged that what is wrong, where the leakages of revenue, whether you are wrongly came exemption, whether valuation issue is there, whether you are not paid tax with the correct rate, etc., etc. There has to be very specific allegation backed up by the evidences or supporting documents and the provisions relied upon for the delegation. Then the documents are very, very important. It must be mentioned in the show cause that for the specific allegation, the CEO has relied upon which evidences, whether it is oral evidence, documents, etc. And to the extent it should be made part of the show cause notice by way of attachment wherever possible. And then it also must contain the contraventions that should be specifically mentioned along with the provision of statute. Lastly, the quantification of tax. This is what is very important. means at the end of the day, when they are issuing show cause notice based on evidence, the it is a duty, and rather I will say it's a mandatory on the part of the officer to mention how much amount he wants to recover by way of issuing the show cause notice. If the quantification is not there, the show cause can turn out to be bad in law. And how that amount is arrived at, whether you want to recover with interest, with penalty, etc., etc., that has to specifically come out. You must have seen income tax notices are running into hardly one or two pages, as against that show cause notice starts with minimum 8 to 10 pages or maybe more than that, depend upon case to case. I have not seen a single show cause notice of a one page or two page, very, very rare, because this much is, which is a basic pillars of show cause notice, you need to include the same. So the show cause notice always runs into a pages and pages. That's one. Then allegation for penalty should also be there. Penalty under various section and what for the penalty. By and large, the penalties are under section 76, 77, and 78. So which particular penalty for what reason they want to invoke, that should be categorically being stated in the show cause notice. So these are the pillars of adjudication and for the show cause notices are concerned. As against that, what is involvement in the assessment? So in the adjudication process, there has to be an allegation to recover tax or interest or penalty or late fee as the case may be. But in the case of assessment, when we have seen in income tax assessment, we are getting the notices. The entire purpose is to determine the income and the tax liability of the assessee. In indirect tax, wherever assessment is there, it's the only deter, like VAT era, there was assessment. So it was determination of the turnover on the tax liability of the assessee. Okay. And it is based on gathering of the information. The only difference is concerned, the assessing officer has got power to gather the information after issuing the notice before completion of assessment. As against that, in show cause notice, all the evidence and information the central excise officer or officer need to gather before issuing the show cause notice. This is a major difference. Okay. So that different, he has to gather that information, evidence, and based on that he alleged. And then once notice comes, thereafter his job is only to pass the order. He cannot ask for any other detail explain except your response, and that too also optional. If you don't want to reply, it may go against you. Even if you want to reply, the officer is supposed to just look into the reply. He can't ask any other document. I have seen the officers are asking, you provide me this detail, this detail. They have no powers. And you are not duty bound to give any other detail unless you wish to give for the purpose of adjudication. This is a major difference coming up between assessments and the adjudication. Because so adjudication requires a presence of specific allegation to recover tax penalty, fees, etc. Whereas assessments is concerned, it is done without allegation. There need not be any allegation in the assessment. Assessment can be simply done just
Hello, Rajiv sir. Can you please unmute yourself?
Sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfect.
So, my apology. This is what I was telling about. We people are concerned almost on the close to retirement. It's Alpesh, you have given me opportunity. That's why I'm again here. But they're finding difficulty with the technology. Fine. The difference between these is there is no concept of assessment order in service tax. You will never get any order in service tax, which is called assessment order, which is there in the direct tax. Now, show cause notice, the powers in the Finance Act comes through only, there's only one section, 73. And seven, there are sub-clauses to it, 73.1 and 73.1A. Now, 73.1 is a main section of show cause notice, which says that Central Excise Officer can issue show cause notice and the time limit is 30 months. 30 months is the provision when the service tax is concerned abolished in the last day. Earlier, to start with, the time limit was 12 months, which was extended to 18 months, and later on it was 30 months. So I have taken the latest provision. When you are handling the provisions, you please check up it is pertaining to which year, and accordingly you can take the limitation. So this 30 months time was there for section 73.1 from the relevant date. Very important. Now, what is relevant date? I have taken up in the next slide. Now, why department officer can issue the show cause? It is only for five reasons. First is if the tax has not been levied, that's first, or it is not been paid, second. Third is it is short levied. Fourth, it is short paid. So these four we can understand. But the fifth has been erroneously refunded. These are the only five purposes for which they can issue the show cause notice. Of course, consequence of this tax is interest and penalty, which is always included within the tax portion. So these are the five purposes for which they can issue the show cause notices. That normal period is 30 months. This is called a normal period. Now, in case of a suppression or fraud or collusion or willful misstatement or any other contravention of the law, but the intention of the taxpayer is to evade the tax, then that time limit of 30 months will be extended to 5 years, which is 60 months, which is called larger period. 30 months is called normal period. In the here, it is called 5 years, that is 60 months is called larger period. Very, very important in this case is, whenever department is issuing the notices invoking the larger period, onus is upon the department to allege that there is a culprit mind and with the intent on the part of the assessee to evade the tax by misusing or violating the provisions. And what are those acts which result into such violation, that should be categorically pointed out and drawn and reproduced in the show cause notice. Simply one liner, if department write that you are not paid the tax, is not enough. It's to justify that there is a culprit mind. Somebody has not paid the tax doesn't mean. See, that's what you can say. There's a difference between accident and murder. If you're driving the car and if you bang somebody and the person dies, it is an accident because you have no intention to kill him. It has happened. And in the other way, if you have decided I want to kill again, then you bang him the car, and that will be obviously result may be the same in both case, but the second will be the murder and the first is an accident. And based on that, in the court of law, you have a different punishment. Okay. The same thing is there in service tax. What is the difference between suppression and a normal period? That has to be categorically alleged and distinguished and mentioned in detail in the show cause, which you need to look into and which you must before responding to it. The next point is, Alpesh, I'm okay with the speed, no, at least. Hello.
Perfect, sir.
Okay. If I'm go, because I'm not able to connect to people, so am I fast, then you please let me know on that.
100%, sir. 100%, sir.
Yeah. The next is, now I said that is 30 month or 5 years is from the relevant date, which is there in section 73 sub clause 6. The dates you must compute properly from this. Now here the possibility is concerned, when the assessee has filed the return, if the return is filed for a particular period. Now, one more thing, let me tell you before that, the difference between adjudication and assessment. Assessment is always for a year, means under VAT or under income tax, you will get assessment for particular financial year or previous year or assessment year. Show cause notice has no such requirement. You can get show cause notice for 1 day, 3 years, 2 months, 19 days, any number of days possible, but maximum period is 5 years. So there is a one notice can be, there is no requirement that it should be financial year wise. It not necessarily it should be return wise. So that is another difference. Now here the possibility is for calculating the relevant date is, there is a two possibility, either assessee has filed the return or not filed the return. So if you have filed the return, the period has to be counted from date on which you have filed the return yourself. And if you have not filed the return, it is a due date on which the return is required to be filed. So your period of 30 months and that 5 years should start based on these two in this scenario. Okay. And there's a case that there's a, any other case apart from return is filed, not filed, is a date on which tax is paid by you. So there may be a possibility of refund, etc. Or there may be any other case where you have just paid the taxes by acting a provisional this thing. Then it will be a date of payment. Okay. Then where the service tax is a provisionally assessed, very few cases I have come across of provisional assessment. But even if it's provisional assessed, then your period starts only from the date of adjustment of service tax after the final assessment. And the last is when your issue is involved, that of refund, the time limit will start from date of granting the refund to you. So this is how your period will start. You must know this and you must apply when you are looking at show cause notices concern. This is a so having explained you section 73 for show cause, for normal period and larger period, there's a one more section 73(1)(a), and which is also, but it is applicable only for periodical show cause notice. What is periodical show cause notice? If the person is concerned as per the CEO is a continuous defaulter, then show cause notice needs to justify with so much explanation. I told you it runs in pages. The department can issue one show cause notice giving all the justification, explanation, provisions, violations, suppression, allegation, etc. Thereafter, for subsequent year, if everything is same except amount and the year, then there is no need to reproduce everything except the year and amount. And if one pager show cause notice can be also a valid show cause notice, if it is a periodical show cause notice, because there is a section 73(1)(a) which provide that department can issue a statement containing detail of service tax for a subsequent period. Very important. There has to be one show cause which is followed by second show cause for subsequent period having same grounds except different period and different amount. Then there can be a periodical show cause notice. So 73(1)(a) whenever invoked, you should see that where is the previous show cause notice. If there is no previous show cause notice, this notice under 73(1)(a) will be bad in law. And that is that you should defend to that extent when you are handling these assignments. Now, next is I have just now specified that the show cause notice normally runs in pages and pages. And why? Because department is supposed to mention so many things, the pillars in the show cause notice, which I have stated. Now, how to get this information for department? So department has got various powers. They can investigate, they can search seizure, they can visit the premises of the assessee, they can call for information with inquiry letter, and the lastly, they can issue summons also to the party for the purpose of giving supporting evidences, documents, detailed explanation, etc., etc. So summons is the biggest weapon. You can say it's a nuclear bomb in the hands of the department to recover or collect, gather information required for the purpose of giving allegations or issuing show cause notice. There is a section 14 of Central Excise Act which deal with summons provision, which has been made applicable to the service tax by section 83 of the Finance Act. Now, every Central Excise officer has a power to summon any person whose attendance is required in person or through representative. And in that process, the attendance can be called for the purpose of collecting a necessary evidences, which may be oral as well as written, or to produce a document, recording of a statement, or any other thing which such officer feels is necessary for the purpose of inquiry. Mind well, this is very important weapon in the hands of the department, and summons is a very serious document. One should take it in the while attending such matter on professional basis. It is a fact-finding stage, and department is inquiring against you. And if you don't respond to the summons, it will be governed by the criminal procedure, CPC and CRPC. So there will be punishment, penalty, and imprisonment also to that extent. Okay, of course, in a rare case, such provisions are invoked. Penalties, of course, are levied, but not the imprisonment, but there is a powers. So person so summon, she is bound to state the truth when he is going there, if he has asked for, and he also need to give the statement. His statement also can be recorded. He need to produce the document, and that will be used by the department as an evidence for issuing the show cause notice. Summons, one has to be very careful, and we to be very serious in all respect. Now, essential of valid show cause notice. Having understood this, the show cause notices are concerned in the service tax regime. The initial period, if you look at in the year 95, 96, 98, those years, we have found many show cause notices were concerned were bad in law. And there are quite a few tribunal decisions to that extent also. And considering that the department has issued a guideline, CBIC, from time to time, that what are the essentials of a show cause notices. The last very important master circular issued by the CBEC is bearing number 96 in January 2017, and which is a very big circular running into 25 plus pages. In that, the certain paragraphs are dedicatedly for the purpose of a show cause notice, having stating that the what are the essential components to constitute a show cause as a valid show cause. It's a guidance to the department as well as it's a clarification for the assessee and the taxpayer. The few of the points that has been clarified, very important this, you must read this circular if you are handling the litigation under the service tax. The first is the show cause notice must contain detail of noticee, whom it is alleged. So if I want to give show cause to Alpesh Doshi, then I'll write down Alpesh Doshi, what is his firm name, proprietorship concern, they mean Doshi and company, whatever it may be, for which address, and the background of the facts, saying that he is a chartered accountant practicing, whatever he is doing, his nature of activity. Then legal framework has been stated. In the legal framework, what are the provision of the statute which are applicable to him and which I feel he has violated. Then secondly, factual statements. Statements I must give him that whether he has filed the return, not filed the return, having filed the return, data is correctly given, not given. It is matching with 26AS, not matching. Income tax return, it is matching. Abatement is wrongly claimed. Exemption is wrongly claimed, whatever. So those things. And for that, whatever I'm writing, what are the evidences I'm relying upon? So did I took his statement under section 14 while recording in response to summons, or I rely upon income tax records, or I report on books of accounts, or any bills, invoices, or 26AS form, or any other documents, agreements, etc. So that evidences I must mention, and I should make part of the show cause notice. This has been stated in the circular. Then I have to also state discussion on the limitation. Limitation is that period, 60 months or 30 months. I must mention that there was a culprit mind in case of Alpesh. He wants to evade the tax with a culprit mind. Intention was there to this thing. That's why I have invoked the larger period, etc. Lastly, based on that, how much amount of service tax I want to recover from you with interest penalty that I need to quantify. So I'll say 22 lakhs rupees I want to recover for this period. I cannot say just 22 lakh. It is for the period April 15 to September 15, whatever. So that I must mention. I must also mention under which service. So chartered accountant service or management consultancy. Specifically, I should draw. Simply, I cannot write you are liable to pay tax. You please pay the tax. You are not paid the tax. These are all the statement will have no relevance unless it has been called. There has to be allegation, which is very important. Or any other due, not only that tax, but I will also say you have not filed the return, please pay the late fee. I want to recover interest under section 75. I also want to recover penalties under 78 for suppression. I will also mention that you have not filed the return, or if you file the return, did not correct. So there's a wrong information given by you. So section 77 is also invoked. Like that, the notice should contain the allegations. And the statement of charge, what are the charge? And the last is the whether the show cause is issued by an authorized person. Suppose I give small, CEO definition, if you see central excise officer, it is principal commissioner to superintendent, all are central excise officers. But every officer has got different powers. You know, suppose your tax demand is above rupees 2 crore, there is no power to superintendent, assistant commissioner, deputy commissioner, joint commissioner, additional commissioner to issue the show cause. It is only the commissioner and principal commissioner can issue the show cause notice. So you must see what is the authority. in that case. So in our today's this thing, for anything about study circle, it is only Himanshu and Alpesh can issue notice to the member, you're not them, because they are sitting on the post, they have got powers. The other are core committee members, so they will not able to do it. So like that in service tax also, same thing, you have to look at the powers. What is the power of the person issuing? And many a time the show cause have been issued by a person who has no power or authority under the law. So that you please also verify, and thereby you can save the client or you can defend the show cause notices. Now, the explanation on every point is concerned is given in the relevant circular. I have reproduced over here some of them. I would not like to read the same thing again and again, but on each point. But if you want to issue show cause notice to multiple assessee, there cannot be same show cause notice. There will be a separate show cause notice to every assessee. If the department want to issue show cause to firm and partner both, there will be separate show cause notice. This is what the clarifications have come in all these circulars, etc., which I am not reproducing here. The limitation period, I already discussed the amount, statement of charge. I think I have explained this part of it, and authority to adjudicate. Now, so in this show cause corona pandemic, whether it is a show causing or it is a shock causing notices, by and large, most of us feel it is a shock causing to us. And it has really in the month of December, with most of our my dear friends were busy either in completing or conducting audit under Income Tax, Companies Act, filing income tax return, meeting other deadlines in GST, etc. These shocking notices have come in the corona pandemic. We on one end, we are finding it difficult to comply the deadline. On the other end, department is issuing SCN without following prophecy. We are not worried about. It is their power and duty and responsibility to collect the taxes, which is their job. So they will be issuing show cause that is within the powers and within the four corner of law. But the only thing is the point to worry or point of grievance is they have not followed the proper process, which is laid down in the master circular and the other circular issued by the CBAC, and the show cause were issued left and right, cut paste, and without taking into account all the points given in the circular, which is pathetic and which is very bad, and it's a harassment. And in some of the cases, the show cause have been issued, even the taxes, in spite of the taxes have been paid, which was really been. Of course, there are black sheeps in the taxpayers as well as in department. Department could able to recover some revenue from that. That's okay. But by and large, in most of the show cause notices are concerned are either bad in law or it will not get a more generation or collection of taxes, except the paperwork and litigation will increase. In my view, at least 3 out of 4 show cause notices are not going to survive the way it has been issued. But only thing is that you need to fight it out till the tribunal or at a higher forum, at the executive level, at adjudication and for appellate level, things may or may not click. It's depend upon the officer and your presentation and submission of document evidence, etc. So crores of rupees show cause notice have been issued even to the professional who are not liable to tax. The show causes have come to doctors, and even to the lawyers also I have seen show cause notices have been come. So show cause is concerned, there is a one important provision is section 73(3) is there, and that is if the person who is chargeable to service tax or the person to whom refund has been granted, and if he has paid the tax on based on his own ascertainment, or if it has been pointed out by the central excise officer, and if he paid the tax along with whatever interest and informed the same to the department in writing before issuing of the show cause notice, then there is a section 73(3) which says that CEO will not serve show cause notice. The word is CEO shall not serve. It's a mandatory. They shall not. But the only thing is that if the CEO proves that this payment is, in spite the payment is made properly with interest, etc., but still show cause is issued because there was an element of suppression, then onus is upon the CEO to prove that there is an element of suppression is involved, and in that then only that show cause notice can survive, no other reason. So this 73(3) will be handy in many of the show cause notice too, in most of the client or many of the client if the taxes have been paid. Secondly, there cannot be any penalty if entire tax is paid along with interest before issuance of show cause notice. During inquiry also, if you have paid, there will not be absolutely no penalties. That is the explanation to section 73.3. Of course, these are all the provisions are concerned. You don't get more favorable orders during adjudication at the adjudicating level or maybe at first appeal level. But if you look at the tribunal decision, there are many tribunal decisions in support. If you can present the case properly with the facts and evidences and document, then there is a lot in your favor comes. If it is all depend upon fact to fact basis. Now, SCN cannot be issued under any other section. You pass, there are decision of tribunal few I have taken. You must see, show cause, first thing you see under which section it is introduced, issued. It can be either 73.1 or 73.1A. If any other section is invoked, that show cause, you need write only one line, this is bad in law. This is not invoked in the correct section. If that is written, you will win the case to that extent. Of course, you will win with the proper justification commentary you will mention. You will succeed not to worry about any other thing. So there's a decision to you early in 2004, Diamond Cable decision is there of Mumbai Tribunal. And where it has been section, the show cause was issued, but there was no section 73 was not invoked. There was no mention about it. When you are invoking, the department is invoking section, they must mention that this show cause is issued in view of so-and-so section. And since it was not invoked, the Honorable Tribunal stated that it's a bad in law and entire demand was quashed. Very important decision for you. There's a next decision that a Gujarat container. In that case is... This is obstructing, no? Gujarat containers case is there, and that is a Mumbai tribunal. In this particular case, the very important point is concerned, the Honorable Tribunal, this is Mumbai Tribunal, has stated that there are various parameters of show cause notice, and show cause notice was had as a bad in law. And why it was bad in law? The adjudicating authority in this case has merely issued the notice directing a person to say by stating that your services are taxable, kindly make payment of this much tax, kindly pay the tax on your service along with interest. And in this case, the demand was not quantified. Like the person was a taxable service provider, the show cause notice alleges that your services are taxable. Whatever is amount is this, you pay tax on it. What is the tax? That was not mentioned. So when that amount was not quantified, the Honorable Tribunal say that this show cause notice is bad in law. It is not following the instructions and the allegations as given by the CBIC. So on what ground? The show cause normally should contain specific allegation, quantification of tax, basis on which the tax has been sought to be recovered. It must be served on proper person and it is issued by the officer empowered. Since all the parameters were not fulfilled, the Honorable Tribunal held that it is a show cause is a bad in law. This is very important decision. In a very, very detailed commentary has been given, very speaking order this is. So you can, of the Honorable Tribunal, those interested can refer to this decision of a Gujarat container, Honorable Mumbai CSTAT vis-a-vis service tax. Then there is another decision is there, and that is of metal forging versus Union of India. This was vis-a-vis excise. It was 146 ELT. And this is also very interesting decision. Here what has happened is, for recovering the taxes, the law has provided that issuing of show cause is mandatory. Mind well, in service tax, unless show cause is issued, you need not pay single tax. Means department has no power to recover tax from you for and without resorting to show cause notice. Only one exception to this is if you have filed the return and in the return you have declared your tax liability and you are not paid the tax fully along with the return. That means, say you declared 10 rupee tax liability in the return and you paid anything less than 10, showing that balance amount, that balance amount, see, if it is a self-assessment, departments can straight away recover the same by resorting to section 87 or any other section. Otherwise, department has no other choice but to issue show cause notice followed by order and then appeal as the case may be for recovery of the demand, if at all they want. So this is mandatory stated by the metal forging case, Honorable Supreme Court. Communication of order, suggestion or advice from the department cannot be deemed to be show cause. Show cause notice has to be, there has to be heading to this entire notice that it is a show cause under section 73(1) or 1A as the case may be. So there has to be specific heading to that, indicating that amount demanded and calling upon assessee to show cause as if he has any objection. If at all, he can defend it by the same demand. This is a decision of the tribunal. The next is Delhi tribunal in the case of Nityananda Nirmal. In this case, there was a partnership firm and show cause notice was served to the partner. The tribunal say it's a bad in-law. You want to recover tax from the firm. You cannot issue the show cause to partner. It has to be alleged to, even if address is same, you should issue to the firm only. Because it is issued in the name of individual partner, it will not sustain. And it was turned out to be bad in-law. And entire demand was quashed by the Honorable Delhi tribunal. So that's why you also be careful when show cause is issued to whom. There is a extended period demand. Yeah, that means I told you what is normal period, 30 months. What is extended period? 60 months. How to calculate that also say from relevant date. Now, whenever department is issuing, invoking the extended period is concerned, it is possible only when there is an element or ingredient like fraud, willful misstatement, suppression, etc. is present and there is clear-cut intention in the minds of the assessee to evade the payment of tax. This must be present and that should be demonstrated in the show cause notice with the supporting evidences by the department. Onus is upon the department to give this allegation supported by the evidence. If that is not there, then you had a good case to argue and succeed. And in that support, you have a decision of Andhra Pradesh High Court, very important in the case of Indian Institute of Chemical Technology. This was vis-a-vis service tax, where it has been held that demand of tax for extended period cannot be sustained merely on the account of non-payment of tax. I told you, no, non-payment of tax doesn't mean there's an intention or evasion. There may be possibility that person may be under bona fide belief that he's eligible for some exemption, abatement, or he's feeling this is not a service, or he feels it's an export of service or something else. But you have to prove why you feel like that. There has to be some, you just one-liner answer can't say. You have to justify it. It's all fact-based. So if you can do it, that is what difference between the accident and murder, which I explained. The same thing here you have to demonstrate. If the assessee provide a reasonable cause for non-payment of tax, the invocation of extended period does not sustain. So if whenever there is an accident, you bang somebody, I'm sure there is no punishment of hang till death, okay? Because there is no intention to kill. There is no element. You may be given imprisonment of 1, 5, 10 years, whatever, but there will not be a hang till death kind of a punishment by the court because there was no intention to kill. Here also, there is no intention of suppression is not there. If you can't prove that, department can't prove, then larger period will not survive. That's what Andhra Pradesh High Court in this case opined or stated, pronounced. Friends, the next is, now what are the points you should keep back of the mind? Few case studies which I have selected. I have seen that the show cause have been issued to doctors, advocates, or the transporters. Now, do you have three, four, few categories? Doctors are concerned, by and large, they are not liable. I'll say by and large, not all. They are not liable. And as regarding the advocate and the goods transport agency, they are liable for payment of tax under reverse charge in many occasions or most occasions. So here, when you are defending a show cause notices which have come recently, either on account of difference in income tax return or 26 AS or non-filing or whatever, you have to first, while drafting the reply, you write about the levy and taxability of your service. So you need to explain what kind of service you are into. So you are supposed doctor. First of all, give evidence that what in support of your qualification degree, you are doctor, you are running polyclinic, etc. So give your qualification certificate, certificate of practice, whatever, whatever, to establish your municipal licenses if you require, so that it is proved that you are doctor. That's one. Then you also talk about the provisions which are being applicable, whereby you are not liable or you are exempted. Maybe under notification 25, there's an entry 21, whereby you are exempted as a professional in medical area, not liable. Then give supporting evidence, give some sample copies of invoices, what kind of treatment reports, etc., so that the officer will know, yeah, he is doctor, he's doing, show your profit and loss account. Also demonstrate that there is no other services you are earning. Sometimes doctor has got renting income. He may be getting renting for his premises. I have come across a case when doctor was practicing, he's a general practitioner, practicing in the clinic. And in his clinic, he was practicing for say 6 hours a day. For rest of the time, he has given this clinic on rental basis to some other doctor. And he was earning the rent. Mind well, he was not paying tax, which is not correct. He is a doctor, but renting is not exempted. So he was very well liable for renting. There was also, I have seen a hospital not paying a tax. Okay. But they have given the cabins on rental basis to various doctors and earned the rent. So hospital is not exempted for the rental income. So these are all you need to demonstrate. You demonstrate with the profit and loss account, show what are the income you have declared under P&L. And for each head, you give a commentary from what you have earned. Give documentary evidence that in support of the, you may have interest income, dividend income, rental income, or salary income, or what not, capital gain income, etc., etc., and say that nothing is taxable. It will be a painful, I know, it will be a very long response, that I also know, but this is the only way you will be able to defend. If you can't do it, you will find the orders will not be in your favor, and your client and yourself will have to go up to the higher forum tribunal or maybe higher. And it may happen that tribunal also will say that why you are not demonstrated with a documentary evidence at the adjudication level or at the first appeal level. So you have to be very careful, like drafting reply. Now, friends, by and large, I have seen, I was also practicing in past in income tax thoroughly. Today also, I do practice limited in income tax. I know that in income tax, when the notice come in assessment, they ask various detail. You give confirmation, you give this agreement, you give whatever, what not, expense detail. So it is mere compilation or submission of the document. In every assessment, I have seen hardly there are 2 or 3 points whereby the assessing officer says that I am proposing to add this to your income or disallow this expense or whatever I want to make, kindly justify. So those kind of 1, 2, 3 points will be there in spite of you have submitted 20, 50 or 100 other papers. In adjudication, this is not the case, friends. In adjudication, there is no requirement to submit any extra paper except which is in support or defending to the allegation. So it is onus is upon you to defend that you are not liable to pay the tax, which is being alleged by the department. So this is about the first. The second is, I've seen advocates and GTA, goods transport agency, got a show cause notice, 2 crore, 5 crore. This is the kind of amount of tax demand. The transporter one or two we are attending, they said, "Arey, I'll be nowhere. I don't have this much asset. I'll have to sell my every asset if I have to pay this much tax with interest penalty." And he was under bona fide belief that there is no tax liability under RCM. Now you have to demonstrate that with the documentary evidences, why you are liable for RCM. You have fulfilled all the conditions of that notification, number 30, etc. So give those consignment copies, bill copies, P&L, etc., and defend, and you can come out. Same way in the case of advocate is concerned. Now, some of the show cause we have seen where issued to assessee who has got multiple business vertical. There are assessees who are in the business of providing service as well as manufacturing goods, as well as trading, etc., etc. Now, mind well, on manufacturing and trading, you are liable either for excise or VAT or both, but there is no element of service. But your turnover in the P&L account shows total turnover, which may be running in crores, but service element may be 5, 10, 20 lakhs, etc. Department has simply issued the show cause notice based on your P&L account or maybe finding out the data from 26 AS. So that is where you will have to justify. In this case, when you are handling this kind of thing, you justify that majority or substantial portion of your turnover is not liable. So for that, you'll have to give your, if you're paid VAT, give VAT audit report, VAT returns, VAT summary, how you are, and few of the sample bills of the VAT, so that you say that it's a mere transaction of sale, not liable for service tax. If you're paid excise on that, give supporting related to excise, and draft and include the challans also, give that you have paid it. Then prepare a reconciliation giving a breakup of service turnover and sales turnover between these, and then demonstrate that whatever the balance is the only service and which is either liable, not liable, below threshold or exemption or export as the case may, and then defend it. This exercise we find people are not doing it. One case recently has come for the appeal. I have seen nothing has been given and the matter has come to appeal for the assessee with a substantial amount of demand, and I am sure that demand is not going to survive because 95% of the demand is only on account of the goods, which is not liable for service tax. But unfortunately, the concerned person has not given the submissions properly in the adjudication. It will unnecessarily, you will suffer, your client will suffer. So that should not happen. The next is, then there are show cause notices which have been issued to assessee who have already availed the abatement. I'll ask you, if you are into repair maintenance business or if you are in the works contract transactions, your turnover is 100 rupees, but the portion on which service tax is payable is after abatement. So you may be paying on 25%, 30%, as the case may be, depend upon the abatement which you have claimed or depend upon the portion on which you have paid VAT, etc. And in the service tax returns, you might have made a mistake by not disclosing the abatement and you have directly given the net figure of turnover. Now, I know the returns are not filed correctly, but that doesn't mean you'll have to pay tax on it. You made a mistake in filing return, that's fine. The department can levy penalty for filing long returns, but they cannot collect the wrong taxes from you. So that you'll have to justify with while responding to the show cause notice, saying that I am eligible for this abatement, demonstrate with the transaction. If there are contracts, please give work order copies, contract copies. You will be, it's a very painful to draft the proper reply because you need to understand what is the allegation and what are the document department is rely upon. So you have to defend, you know, defending the case is concerned requires not only presence of mind, but you have to be very, very crisp and to the point. Only your answer should be rotated around the allegation only. Don't give anything extra. There's no need. It will not add up to anything except unless you stick and focus to the allegation. Then also provide the detail of a turnover which is relevant only for service tax, and also give turnover which is not relevant for service tax since you already paid VAT, etc. on this part of it, and you can defend. Also, straight away mention that service tax returns, I made this mistake. It was there, fine, but I have declared the net turnover instead of the gross turnover. Please mention that. This all will help you in the tribunal if the case goes against you in the adjudication process. Then show cause notices are concerned. Here the breakup you need to give a statement should be given year wise, and also look at the notification because the periodicity of the notification giving benefit also will be from different dates are there. So you need to mention that. And then sometimes the contracts are concerned, there are exemption under notification 25 and 26 of relevant 2012 year. In that the exemption is vis-a-vis the government. So you need to also say that the who is the party who has given you the contract, whether it is a government authority or no. Sometimes I have seen the contract comes from PWD, CIDCO, municipality, or any other body. So you have to demonstrate and justify that it's a government and I'll be eligible, I'll not be eligible. That's how it is. Don't give general statement. The general statement, if you give, then you will not get things in your favor and you'll be unnecessarily roped in for the higher forum appellate, and which is costly. The lastly, one more thing is that even the chartered accountants are not being spared. I've seen my dear friends, peers and professional brothers are also being issued notices. Let us not blame the department as the case may be. They are doing their duty. We should do our duty. Now, in the case of CA, I found the one or two matters we are also handling in that process. I have seen that CA may be following cash system of accounting in his books of account. Then 26 years and is always a challenge to match, because your customers might have deducted TDS based on accrual. So it will rarely match. That's one. In service tax regime, if you your turnover was below 50 lakhs, you need to pay the tax on cash system. Some chartered accountant follow a mercantile system, but pay the tax on cash system for service tax, etc. So you please demonstrate. Now, I have seen that department, the case which we are handling, 26AS shows your turnover 50 lakhs. And in your P&L, it is shown 35 lakhs, 15 lakhs. Why the difference? Balance 35 lakhs taxable. Then we have to say, bhai, in our profession, it is the father who raises the bill and son who collects the payment. So, humko 50 lakh ka bill to si bill bante, 15 lakh ki haath mein aata hai, baki 35 lakh bachcha collect karte 5-10 saal ke baad. So, I will not be paying tax till I recover the money in view of the provision of Rule 6.1, which says that I am eligible to pay tax. I'll be liable to pay tax only as per Rule 6.1, and that is based on the recovery of tax. Let me tell you one more thing on that. There is a case which is very interesting that please wait for 1 minute. There is a disturbance at my place. 1 minute. Hello. My apology. There is some repairing going on. Voice is there. Sorry. One case we are facing right now is there is a chartered accountant who has less than 50 lakhs of professional fees, and his billing was more than 50 lakh, but he has correctly paid service tax following the cash system as much amount he has received, etc. Now, in the show cause notice, when he has gone to the department for making the submissions, okay, and the hearing, etc., the department has told him, ki, okay, you have issued only in this year, when you have issued the other amount, balance amount, so that may be in the year 2018, 19 or 20. So department say, please pay tax for the same. Please don't pay the tax. Mind well, I told you, this show cause notice is must, even if department want to recover the tax for subsequent year, by virtue of 6.1, they cannot say that we have issued show cause from 14 to 17. And if you have received the payment in 2018-19, there will be separate show cause notice required to be issued to you for making payment of tax. So there is no requirement that you should pay the taxes to that extent, which is very, very, very important to that. You should keep back of the mind. The next, so this is about the chartered accountants. When it comes to the next is, you can demonstrate with the help of your bank statement or confirmation from party that I have received payment on this day, and nothing was received. There may be element of reimbursement of expenses, like you might have paid ROC filing fees of the client or any such payment or some stamp paper, stamp duty, etc. Then on the taxes that you must demonstrate, give with the help of this. This is what we have come across when we're handling one or two chartered accountant cases are concerned. You can take cognizance of this. Then we also seen the surprising show cause notice issued to a person who is no more. You know, even the person who is deceased, the show cause notice have come. So the indirect tax is so horrible that even if you leave this world, it still it doesn't leave you unless it recovers the last penny. So this is very, very important for you to know that show cause cannot be issued to deceased person. It is a void ab initio straight away. The deceased person, once the person has expired and he is no more, the show cause cannot be issued to his legal heir also, nothing. The matter is closed. And there are decision to that extent. One is a Premier Security, that is of Chennai Sistad, Bharti Mulchan Cheda, which is of Mumbai Sistad, and there's a D. Matai, which is also of Mumbai. Here, once the assessee is expired, is a deceased person, show cause will be bad in law immediately, and you need not have to worry it. And in fact, one or two cases we reported in our name also in the tribunal, where Mumbai tribunal, where it has been held that the taxes cannot be recovered, even if it is recovered and paid, recovered by you from the customer, it cannot be recovered from the legal heirs. The next, so I have come across cases where show cause have been issued to 100% export turnover of service provider. His entire turnover is export of services. There is no tax payable. Okay, but unfortunately, he has not taken the number, assuming or under bona fide belief that if I have no tax liability, I need not pay the tax. Mind well, even if you are export of service, you should have taken the number, although there is no tax liability. Now, show cause have come. So show cause have come, nothing to worry about. Even if there's a violation of not taking the number, department can levy some penalty for violation of law of not taking registration is fine, but there is no tax liability. So please demonstrate with the help of all documents that why your services are export, etc. And also place of provision rules. You need to write commentary on that. And your contracts with the customer, payment received in convertible foreign exchange. So you are complied with rule 6A of the service tax rules that it is a export of services, and that's why you are not paid tax. We have one or two cases where entire 100% export service provider also is issued show cause notice. Customers agents have been issued show cause notice because they have recovered many amount from the customer, which are pure in a capacity of payor agent. It's a pure reimbursement, but the amount is appearing in the financial statement. Now, suppose in his financial statement, total 10 crore rupees appearing, but service portion is only 1 crore. The 9 crore is on account of customs duty or any other reimbursement which they have incurred and paid. The department is trying to recover tax on entire 10 crore, which is not the case because that is not a consideration for service, but it is a pure reimbursement. You need to justify it with the valuation rules and saying that this is to be excluded from the consideration. And the next part is concerned in this, there are many decisions in your support. Sharma Cement Clearing Agency, Avasthi Brothers, these are all recent decisions, 2020 and 17. In past also there are decisions are there, and but directly don't jump onto the decision. First give documents, facts in support of your contention or defense. Now friends, Kalpesh, I think few of the cases which I thought of, which I am rather handling, I have given my experience. I think if members or anybody has any queries on show cause or any of these proceeding, you can ask. I think the stuff which I could explain. Now over to you, sir. Either you can route through somebody.
So there are four queries been raised. Disha is just sharing the screen. Yeah. Disha just share the screen.
Yes, Alpesh bhai, I'm sharing the screen.
I'm sorry, I could not able to, because there are many, many show causes have been issued. The live cases I shared is whichever we are handling, few of them.
So these are the four queries.
Yeah.
Alpesh bhai, just adding one more query.
Yeah.
Yes.
Shall I start on this by the time?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The first query, if we are providing export services, are we liable for registration in service? I think that was the last slide which I was dealing with. If yes, but if exports, so no liability, then why show cause? What is the penalty for non-registration? If no, then no show cause, no penalty. Yes. See, first of all, let me tell you, you look at the definition and the threshold exemptions, what have been given. Okay. Threshold exemption, export is concerned. The gentleman whosoever is asked this query, your turnover is concerned is always taxable. The service which you have provided and which you trying to classify under rule 6A of the export of service, that is always a taxable service. Like you as a chartered accountant, your clients are located outside India. Okay. And they take your some service of advice, consultancy, whatever. I know it is export of service, and assume that if all your clients are abroad. Now, mind well, your service are not exempted. They are taxable. But just because the reason it is fulfilling the criteria of exports laid down in rule 6A, you are not paying tax. The services can be exported, but the taxes cannot be exported is a principle. By virtue of that, you won't be paying the taxes and you will be eligible for a refund of input service if required. Now, there is no bar, there is no exemptions whatsoever, for the guy that not to register. Every person whose turnover exceeds 10 lakhs rupees in a year at relevant, not 10 lakh, even 9 lakh, was required to take the registration of a taxable turnover. So your turnover once crosses that 9 lakhs, you have to register and you have to file the return. Sir, you are telling your services exporter as an officer, how I will know that it is exempted, sir? Because what is there back of your mind with documentary evidence, it may or may not be correct interpretation. So if you are registered and if you are filing the return, in the return, there is a column to declare how much amount of service are exported. You mention everything over there. Then as an officer, I will verify whether what you are saying, what is your contention is right or wrong. It may not be right. Your services may not be exported as per my interpretation. So don't get shocked and surprised. This notice has correctly been issued to you. You have to demonstrate and say that there is no tax liability. Once there is no tax liability, the questions come, why you are not registered? There is a one or two case laws of Mumbai Tribunal. I don't have handily available, but I know the person who has, if he is not registered subject to a condition that his entire service are exported, registration is not required. This is what decision of Mumbai Tribunal in one of the case. If I lay my hands to it in a day or two, I will definitely forward it to convener Alpesh. That is what, in my view, registration was required. But if you are not registered, I'm sure department will not levy penalty for non-registration and non-filing of the return, because there is no loss of revenue and you will succeed in this case. So Shokar's coming to you is not a shock, but you need to reply properly on this part. That's first. The second is, in case of a doctor, notice was received for failure to obtain registration. Reply filed in October, November. Reply filed stating not liable, attaching the degree certificate. Doctor registration, specifying the section that service not liable. No communication thereafter. This is for period 15-16 onwards. No SCN till now. Whether same can be issued now? Yes, it can be issued, because financial year 15-16, the time barring is concerned, it is 5-year period is available to them. 5 years will be counted in this fashion, that the 30th for September 15, return was due on 25th of October, unless it is extended. So 24th of October 2020 was the last date, larger period, which was extended up to 31st of December. And if it is further extended, then it can be. For March 16, yes, it is still pending up to 24th of April 2021, notices can come. I hope when you responded to the simple inquiry letter you have submitted, but if you would have given P&L account showing all the income, he doesn't have any other income apart from medical, that would have been more convincing that he is, because doctor not necessarily fully exempted. He may have some other income. Hopefully in your case, it is not there, then it's good. And also you need to give few sample copies of invoices. If the doctor is general practitioner, they don't give invoices, then some sort of a record keeping register for income tax, you must be maintaining, you know, cash receipt register for the medical fees, etc. If that will give with P&L account, that would have been much better. But yes, there's a time still to issue the notice in your case. Received a demand notice to pay service tax of rupees 4 due to difference in turnover. You are lucky that you got it for 4 rupees. One of our client got it for 1 rupee only. So this was also a big shock to us. During past 4 years, what is the course of action? I think, do you think we should waste time on 4 rupees, sir? I think we have a lot of good thing to do in this world. Perhaps let us not discuss anything about this. If you want to take this matter to the Prime Minister, that's fine, because you can mention as a citizen of this country, saying that for recovery of 4 rupees, you are spending more than 4,000 rupees of time. That perhaps may be eye-opener for our Prime Minister or Finance Minister. But otherwise, sir, if it is payable and Shokar has come, I will take my answer is there, without going into nitty-gritties, just pay and give the demand. 4 rupees is something I don't think, it's only a big shock, but this shows that the person issuing show cause notice and person signing the show cause notice is just not looking at it, applying, only working mechanically. Otherwise, the respected person who has issued the show cause should have seen 4 rupees. There is no effort is required and they should not. Of course, anything above 1 rupee, they can recover. Huh? That let me tell you. In income tax, I have been told that up to 25 rupees of demand, if it is not paid, government doesn't recover. But there is nothing of that kind in service tax. It is up to 1 rupee. Anything above 1 rupee, they can recover. Assessee has joined as an assistant in the legal firm. Legal firm means whether it is a law firm, is an advocate firm or chartered accountant firm. I don't know from here. The queries can clarify this. Whether it is a law firm, advocate firm or chartered accountant firm. So yes, law firm. That means I presume it's a lawyer's firm. Okay. Whether his service provided to legal firm would be taxable. In my view, no. Presuming that he is also a lawyer. If he himself is a lawyer and rendering service to another lawyer, there will not be a tax liability whatsoever. He is not a lawyer. He is not a lawyer, he is writing. So if he is not a lawyer, then he is getting salary or professional fees. That is also one thing. If he is getting salary, out of question. But if he is getting professional fees, then it is only lawyer who is being providing a legal service was not liable to pay tax. But the other than lawyer, if he is providing services, there was no exemption whatsoever. If it is above the threshold limit, then yes, it will be liable. It may be a legal service, but not provided by lawyer. So it will be liable to tax in my view. And there is no exemption for services provided by other than lawyer to a law firm. So there is no exemption available to this transaction and you will end up paying taxes on this in my view. Yeah, any other issues, sir, on this?
Sir, forum will take another queries. Forum, yeah. Can you share your screen?
Yeah, I can share. There is another query somebody is asking.
Yes, sir. Sir, CS compile, she is sharing the screen.
Achha, okay. You are sharing. By the time I'll yes. share my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. 1 second. Disha, you can ask me orally also if you feel compiling takes time, etc. No, I have no problem. Yes. We have enough time still, but I leave it to you. I have no problem. And if you require, we can go through chat box also.
Yes. Disha, you can read out the things.
Yes, sir. One second, Alpesh bhai. One second.
You want me to go through chat box, ma'am?
No, sir. We will do that. Alpesh bhai, only 2 minutes,
sir.
Yes, sir. Of course. So there was one query that if Shoko is not issued.
Yes.
But before the service tax paid in Sabka Saath scheme, then yes. Is it valid?
Yeah, see, what happened is the SVA scheme, which was there last year, there was a separate cell which was formed by the department to handle this SVA's application. It was not the jurisdiction officer who was involved in this SVA's. Your application was going to a separate cell of commissioners. Okay. So what happened is this SVA scheme was there up to, I think extended was up to 15 January. And thereafter, SVDLR-4, the discharge certificate took 1 or 2 months time. In some cases, that is not been issued till today because thereafter that pandemic of COVID has caused a lot of hardship to the government or department. Now, your jurisdiction officer is concerned, he has no idea or he may not be having enough information that you have gone for SVA scheme. So in that case, if you have got a show cause notice and for that particular period, you have gone for SVA scheme by declaring this thing, then yes, you can intimate to the department. But let me clarify one thing. Your SVA scheme, there are various options. It is voluntarily you have gone or based on your arrears or based on show cause, various litigation, what for you have gone in SVA. What the scheme was providing that, to the extent you have availed the benefit of the scheme on the portion of value of taxable services, the department thereafter will not issue show cause only for that portion. For balance portion, your matter is live. I'll give example, Alpesh. Suppose in your case, you being a chartered accountant, you have some 60 lakhs rupees of your fees, suppose, for financial year 15-16. Then, and assume that you are not paid tax on any amount. Okay, 60 lakh fully. Having registered, not registered, it can be anything. Now, in the SVA scheme, you thought of, ki, okay, we'll pay on, say, 40 lakhs. Okay, so you have gone on SVA scheme, paid tax on 40 lakhs. Now, if show cause notice is issued to you thereafter, you got a discharge certificate for 40 lakhs. And if show cause is issued to you for, say, 60 lakhs, then to the extent of balance 20 lakh, it is still valid. Okay, so okay. To whatever extent you are, so onus will be upon you to just prove and justify that the whatever amount of tax is sought to be recovered through the show cause notice is already included while filing my SVDLR-1 form. If you can substantiate with a documentary evidence, then that show cause will be decided in your favor otherwise. But there is no bar in issuing show cause. Show cause they can very well issue.
Next was, notice has been received on account of difference between ST3 and 26 AS.
Yes.
Where SSE has been following receipt basis for service tax matter.
Correct.
However, some part of invoices as per 26 AS has not been received by a client, and we have written off that has bad debts in next year or two.
Yes.
So what should be our approach for that, and what sort of document we should compile for the same to justify bad debts?
I think I have already explained you in this, but let me tell you what I have understood with this question is 26 AS reconciliation with your P&L account. This is what the reconciliation base, and you say that you have followed a cash system for your profit loss, whatever. And service tax was also, or you may be following mercantile system, but you have paid service tax on cash basis. I presume that you are eligible. That means your turnover is below 50 lakhs. You fulfill that requirement of Rule 6, which is because for everybody, cash system was not permitted. So yes, I presume you are below that limit prescribed in Rule 6. If that being the case, you first see it show cause is for which year. Assume your show cause is only for financial year 15-16. Okay. Now, what is your onus? I'm sure you might have filed your return for 15-16. Okay. And in the return, whatever tax liability is there, correctly paid by you based on the receipt basis. And in your P&L account, something more is there. On in 26A, something more is there. Then, and which you have written off by way of bad debt in subsequent year, this year, that year, whatever. If I'm there at your place, what I will say, that department is telling you there is a difference, you have provided this taxable service, please pay tax, this amount along with interest penalty. What you have to say is, you draw the attention to Rule 6. Rule 6, which is laying down the criteria that you are eligible for paying tax on cash basis, okay? And that demonstrate with the evidences of your turnover and you are fulfilling. Then also mention you have opted for the same, which you have disclosed in your returns while filing ST3 return. Then you say that during 15-16, I have received only this much amount, that's all. So I have paid tax on that amount. Don't talk about the balance amount. Whether you have written off, not written off, that is none of his business. See, as an officer, suppose I am officer, what I have alleged, you are not paid tax for this year. Now, you are not paid for this year. So you say, I have not received amount in this year. That's all. When I have received thereafter, why I have not received, why I have written off, that forget about it. Just say, if you write bad debt and ye wo na, see, kya hota hai, kam khane se apna pet bharta nahi hai aur jyada khane se apacho ke na Gujarati apacha ho jata hai, usko pachta nahi hai. So department ko jyada bhi denge to bhi theek nahi rahega. You have to say provision what they say, ki you have to pay tax on the receipt basis, Rule 6. So you say, I have paid tax. And you want to recover more for this year, there is no liability for this year. If there is liability for subsequent year, this show cause notice is not enough to recover the tax for that. Okay. So we are not here to teach or educate the department. We are here just to defend. So that's why I'm telling you, try to understand the allegation. If you know the allegation, justify, rest all, keep quiet.
Perfect.
Don't talk about bad debt. The moment you talk bad debt, I am sure the order will go against you. Of course, it will not survive, but unnecessary, you will have to fight for up to tribunal.
Okay. So thereafter, client is in a business where he takes trucks on hire.
Yes.
And he provides transport of service to his customer.
Yes.
Can he be covered under GTA?
Yeah, obviously he is GTA, but there is no tax liability. Because truck on hire, there is an exemption notification entry 25 is there, I believe. In 25 number notification, truck hire, no tax. And when you provide service under GTA, your customer, I presume, all are falling in that category 7, which is prescribed for payment of tax under reverse charge. So your customer are either partnership firm, private limited, public limited, government companies, etc. So everything is under RCM. There cannot be any tax liability. So you are not liable, and you are not liable, you are not required to register also, sir.
After the SSC has not shown his export turnover in his service tax return.
Yes.
So there is a mismatch between income tax and service tax return.
Correct.
Therefore, show cause notice is issued for difference amount. How to deal with such cases?
Yeah. So you are contending that there is an export. No. So plus prove it with a documentary evidence that this is an export of services. So your contract with client, his location, place of supply, prove it, where, which category is falling into. And thereafter, you give your bill copy, also give foreign inward remittance certificate, FIRC, in support of the claim that you have received the payment in convertible foreign exchange. See, there are six conditions laid down in Rule 6A. For any transaction to be termed as export of services. Okay. So you fulfill all the six transaction condition that give a commentary on that supporting documentary evidence, and then say these are export of services and which are not being disclosed by omission, oversight or misunderstanding by us due while filing the return. Just agree to your mistake. Just say it will happen. It has happened. So there is no intention. But also say that since there is no tax payable on the same, that's why it has not been given and which you are giving. So what will happen? Perhaps possibly department may levy you penalty for filing a wrong return, which cannot be more than 10,000 rupees. Okay. But there will not be any tax liability. In my view, most cases, they will not levy penalty also. Okay, but suppose some scrupulous officer levies it, then 10,000 is the max. It is a damage comes to you,
defect.
But no tax
defect. Perfect. Sir, there was one thing. The chartered accountant has replied to the notice in October by email and speed post. Still, the client are receiving the show cause notice.
Sir, you have replied means what happened? It was during the inquiry and investigation stage. The department has collected some details. Okay. That is must know. I told it is their power to collect those tax information because they have to allege you in the show cause. So that is right. Which you have submitted physically, registered email, whatever. Now, based on that, the department came to a conclusion, perhaps, that there is a leakages of revenue and some tax is due from you. So obviously, show cause will come. Now, whether it is right or wrong, that now you have to see. Sir, I'll put it this way, sir. You are an honest person. You have a railway ticket or pass. But still, TC can ask you ticket. No, sir. See, you are going from Mulund to VT. Every railway station, but TC can ask you ticket. No, you can't say, kitna bar puchta hai. You may be frustrated. It's okay. But different TC can ask you ticket. No, because here it is, onus is upon you to prove the ticket. There is no amount collected from you because you have got a ticket. But you can't say ki usko power nahi hai. So here show cause notice, he can issue to you, sir. There is absolutely no bar.
Yeah, and last one, notice issued for difference between 26 years and ITR and ST3. No ST3 was filed.
Achha.
All explanation given, given including balance sheet, sales register, full amount of service tax paid. But in spite of tax paid challan given, show cause notice issued ignoring all details which was submitted. Out of total amount of tax, only 4 lakhs was paid under SVLDR scheme. But superintendent ignored and show cause notice issued for 20 lakhs. Including service tax, which can be, what can be done again to file all documents, or whether 20,000 can be charged for non-filing of ST3 returns. And last was, in spite of SVLDR scheme, is it interest applicable on whole amount or on waiver on SDLR amount paid?
The facts are very long. If I miss out something, Alpesh, you need to tell me again.
Yes,
as I have understood, here is concern this gentleman. He has one important line during your question. You said that he has not filed the return. Not filed the return. And he has paid some portion as a tax. I don't know whether it is right, wrong, fully paid, partly paid. Let us not go into that. Then further in the fact, you have stated that he has gone for this SVS scheme for some 4 lakh, etc., etc. Now, what I'm trying to say here is that, and some detail were also been submitted, income tax return, 26 AS department has got, but you don't have, you are not filed ST3 returns. So your service tax returns are not there. This is what in the facts you have mentioned.
Yes.
Now the question is concerned, suppose I am an officer. Now you are telling why show cause, whether I can issue show cause. Now tell me as an officer, what I have got in my hands is your IT return. Suppose IT return shows some X amount as your turnover of services. Then your 26 AS, it will say some Y amount on that TDS is deducted. Then I will try to, as an officer, I want you, the law provide that you should file your ST3 return self-assessment with declaring correct taxable turnover, which you have not done it. So you are one defaulter. So now when you are not filed, I should have collected relevant information. So what is relevant information? So from PNL 26 years, I can get it. Normally, whichever is higher, I will do it. Okay. PNL account or 26 years. Normally, yeah? Okay. But it should be PNL account credit side in my view should be the correct one. Now in that support further, you said that you have gone for SVA scheme. You have paid some 4 lakh rupees tax. And SVDLR-4 form discharge also you got it, and which you have submitted to me. Now the question comes is that, sir, you have gone for SVA scheme. I told you it's a separate wing, separate department. It is not with me. What all you have declared there, I don't have any information. Secondly, the category under which you have declared, is it a disputed due, arrears, a voluntary disclosure, that is written in the form. Now in this case, you select it for voluntary. That means I will presume that it is something which is amount which is on which you feel tax is payable, but you are not paid, and that you are paying now in the scheme to save yourself from the tax and interest and penalty, whatever benefit. Okay. Now that doesn't prove that whatever is taxable disclosed in your PNL account on which you are paid fully tax. How will prove, sir, as an officer, how I will know that you have paid that tax? Okay. अगर आपने सर्विस टैक्स का रिटर्न भरा होता, इफ यू हैव पेड सर्विस टैक्स रिटर्न, देन यू विल से माय टर्नओवर इज एक्स अमाउंट एंड ऑन दैट दिस मच इज एक्सपोर्ट, दिस मच इज एक्सेम्प्टेड एंड बैलेंस पे आई हैव पेड टैक्स, ओके, एंड आई वुड हैव मैच दैट टर्नओवर विद योर पीएनएल अकाउंट. अभी रिटर्न तो फाइल नहीं किया है आपने, एंड योर टर्नओवर इन पीएनएल अकाउंट और इन 26 ईयर्स शो समथिंग मोर, एंड योर डिस्क्लोजर इज समथिंग एक्स वाई जेड अमाउंट व्हाटएवर. Then there is, I don't have any justification, documentary evidence in my hand to justify that your entire tax liability, your discharge. That's why I issued the show cause notice. Now when show cause has come, what is your role to play is you demonstrate with the documents and explanation saying that what all was taxable for that particular year for which show cause has come, it is appearing in your PNL account. You give a breakup and consolidated statement. How much tax payable, please compute along with the justification, and also give supporting few bill samples for reference wherever you are not paying tax. Wherever you are paying tax, you need not worry. But wherever you are not paying tax, you please justify. And then also give explanation that why you have gone for VCS, for what portion out of this. Okay. So you might have gone for entire amount, then there's no problem. If it is part amount, then you say, and for balance amount, what about the tax liability? If you can give this reconciliation, then in while adjudicating, the officer will be relying upon those documents and then he will drop the demand. So your task will be very challenging and difficult here, because you'll have to do a proper exercise of reconciling the thing. Just merely you have filed SVDLR. I will, yesterday only one matter I'll share with you, sir. There is a works contract service provider, is somewhere from Thane, and for financial year 14-15, okay, he has taxable service, and he has what kind of liability amount is there, I don't know, but he has paid about 8-10 lakh rupees of tax, of service tax, including VAT also he might have paid 8-10 lakh rupees. Now that tax he has paid way back in 2019, okay. Then what happened is in 19 December, there was a SVA scheme. So he has gone in SVA scheme, and in the scheme, exact amount of tax which he has already paid in June 19, he has declared that as is a taxable turnover. He has not filed ST3 returns, huh? But he has gone for VCA scheme. And in that, he has mentioned it's a voluntary contribution on that I am paying tax. Okay. So he has paid tax and he has got SVDLR 3 with a correct estimate. In response to that, he has submitted the challan that he, I already paid the tax. Kindly issue SVDLR-4. His SVDLR-4 is rejected, saying that this tax was paid by you in 2019, and which was paid much before your filing SVDLR. There cannot be voluntary of it. If you are paying voluntary, you should have paid after this the estimation of STR. So that is on one ground matter is going on. Simultaneously, he got a show cause notice saying that you have this much tax liability. On that, you have not paid the tax. So please pay with interest and penalty. Now, in that response, he has already paid the tax in 19, but not filed the return. Now that officer is telling that this tax is paid. It is on which turnover? Please justify. And please justify me. He is finding it difficult to justify. So he has to go to P&L account, which he has filed in the income tax. And from that every turnover, he is trying to give a statement that this is a turnover, this on amount I paid VAT, this amount service tax payable, on that how much this much tax is paid. And for which SVA scheme may it is rejected. So now he will be liable for interest and also the penalty. And he has not filed the STT return. So late filing fee also and for non-filing of the return. So all these consequences. This guy could have saved his entire thing. I am sure now we will end up paying everything with interest and penalty in spite the scheme has gone. This is just because the documents and the details and the case was not presented properly. This was only yesterday's matter I am telling you. So in the case of your this particular question, you be careful on that front.
Okay. So therefore, in case of non-AC luxury point-to-point passenger bus service provider company, show-cause notice received stating your entire service taxable submitted the registration certificate and has non-AC buses and that dealing in exempted service. How to different now?
Yeah, yeah. So you, whatever, I presume you have 5, 10, 20, whatever number of buses you have, please give the registration certificate of the RTO of the buses, what are the ownership, what you are running into. And you demonstrate with the document that these are all non-air conditioned buses. You must be issuing tickets also to your customers, no, in that non-AC charge, etc., what you are levied. And then you say that this no, by entry number so-and-so or the section so-and-so, there is no tax liability on the tours under tour service category for the non-air condition. I presume it is under the after 2012, so it is a service. It is not a service per se. And it is completely exempted under notification 25 of 2012. And so thereby, and some sample copies of bills for every financial year you give, I think that will be enough for you to this thing and appear for personal hearing along with that. You will have to ensure that what all documents will justify or substantiate that your entire buses were non-air conditioned. That is very, very, very important. You will have to give those documents and then put it in writing. So there should not be any problem on this, sir.
Sir, department has given a time limit of 30 days to reply from the receipt of show-cause notice.
Yes.
The chartered accountant are still working from home. Is it compulsory to reply within 30 days?
No, it's not like that. The show cause notice is concerned. The department has to give a reasonable time. 30 days is termed as a reasonable time. If you find it difficult for whatever reason, either work from home or you may have other priorities, other commitment, there may be possibility you are in a process of collecting the various evidences, which are old papers, you are locating that, client is these, that there can be 100 reasons for not able to respond within 30 days. Okay. So what I feel is the correct procedure is you give in writing a letter saying that this is the reason, 1, 2, 3, what all is actual reason or factual reason you are facing that you mention and seek for adjournment 1 month, 2 months. Don't ask for 1 year, but a reasonable time, 1 or 2 months is a reasonable time. And you also mentioned that we would like to have personal hearing in any case. So what happened? I have not seen show cause notices so far so good have been decided ex parte. That is, unless the person is very thick-skinned guy and in spite of 3-4 reminders given by department, he is not responding at all. No officer I have seen so far has behaved so nastily and they will not do it also, absolutely. So you pass, only thing is please convey in writing and seek for adjournment and also give some reasonable ground. You want 2 months. No, you mention that this is a reason I have to collect these, that, and I'll submit in 2 months. They will definitely give you time for 2 months and they are duty bound to give you, let me tell you.
Okay. In ST3, instead of mentioning taxable value of service render, the taxable value of receipt were provided. Also paid tax on receipt correctly. Is there any issue for not mentioning value of taxable service render?
See, return was having two separate columns, I recollect. One yes. column is the value of taxable service provided, and second may how the tax being calculated based on the value. So in that case, you would have written two separate figure. One in the value provided, and second is amount which is liable to tax. Those two separate columns were already there. Now, if you have not done it to that extent, you have not filed your returns correctly. Okay, you can't undo it because that all returns are now closed. Revision power, time limit, everything is gone. But suppose you receive a show cause notice. You just honestly accept it that this is a mistake which has been committed. You know, error can be committed. But there's no intention to defraud the revenue because you already paid the taxes. So while you can give statement in writing, provided you get show cause notice saying that this was a taxable service provided or billed during the year. And this was a taxable service on which I was supposed to pay the tax based on the cash system as per rule 6. Two separate statement you give it and you say, I have made a mistake while filing the return, which is unintentional with a intent. There's no intention to evade. So department is concerned. Yes, they will be agreeing to it. See, filing of incorrect return will never raise any result into any demand whatsoever. Because I told you, this is adjudication. Adjudication is everything based on allegation. So unless department alleges to recover the money from you, there will not be recovery. And if they have alleged, then you defend, na? Okay, return was incorrect, fine. But actually, there is no liability. I also replied in the case of export, no? You are not mentioned in the export, in the return. No problem. Okay, jo ho gaya, ho gaya. But that doesn't mean there will be liability on that part of it.
Export of service.
Yeah.
However, person providing and receiving are related party that are separate companies.
Yeah.
Is there any liability of service tax on said amount?
If not at all. Not at all. Not all. It is only between transaction between branches. It will not be treated as export. Right? Whether it is subsidiary, related party, whatever 48-2B and accounting standard AS-18, all the work which be applicable. Nahi hai. It's only a branch of same entity located in two different countries or two different places. The transaction will not be treated as export. Rest all. Even if you are holding company, subsidiary company, there is no problem.
Clients collect octroi and charges of 2% has service charges on same.
Yes.
Both are shown as octroi charges in P&L credit and yes. Octroi charges are debited to P&L debit.
Yes.
And the difference of 2% can be treated as value of service or entire octroi service can be treated as value of service.
Only the 2% service charges are the one which is value of taxable service. First principle, there are decisions. There is no tax on tax. See, octroi is a tax. It's a duty levied by municipal corporation. So that is not a consideration for service, sir. That is the amount which you have recovered from the customer because you already paid to government on his behalf. It is nothing but pure agent capacity may you have paid the tax. That's a fund support. Secondly, it is a tax element. There cannot be tax on tax. Like that, the custom duty is being collected. I have given an example. Custom house agent, 10 crore rupees showing in the P&L account, but his agency is only 1 crore because that 9 crore include customs duty and all. There cannot be tax on taxes. Yeah, there, so absolutely no problem whatsoever. You will not be liable. Even for TDS also, you can't deduct on the gross amount. There cannot be TDS on the gross tax, etc. So rest assured, nothing will happen. Only thing you demonstrate properly, yeah? Give copies of bills. In that show, this much amount is octroi, say 50,000 octroi, 1,000 is fees, your service charge. And that's how you show some 10, 20 bills and also give a breakup of every year's financial year. So there, and also say that, in accounting system followed by me, instead of showing the service size net, I have shown on gross. And on the left-hand side, that is on expense side, I have shown the octroi duty paid. That is accounting. See, even if there is accounting right or wrong, the tax cannot be recovered. Huh? Accounting error does not result into tax liability, mind well. You, whether your accounting is right or wrong, that department is not concerned.
Right, sir. Sir, to our previous query of that long data about that P&L was not mentioned and 4 lakhs only paid. Thus, whether the office is justified in charging 20,000 late fees for not filing of ST3 returns?
Yeah, obviously, because there is a penalty. This is Section 70 requires you to file the returns, and Section 77, read with Rule 7B, which is laid down the penalty, which is in the form of late fees. For non-filing of the return. If he has invoked this and alleges this in the show cause, he can recover and charge and pay, collect 20,000 rupees late fee. Yes, he can do it, sir.
Okay. So question. The show cause notice received and replied some 7-8 months back.
Yes.
Thereafter, nothing came from the department. Mm-hmm. Whether the taxpayer knows that whether the matter is closed or is still open, how can we come to know about the same?
Sir, you are lucky, only 7 months. We have one show cause notice replied in 2011. And let me tell you that a person was proprietor has expired also now. And we means as on today, hearing has not come. Okay. 2011 matter. I don't know what has happened and all. So 7 months is a reasonably good period if you compare with that. But don't worry. Matter is concerned. It will not be concluded unless you get an order. So like I told you, if you appear for exam, Mumbai University, result aega, kabhi aega pata nahi, but it will come. It is either you will be pass or fail. Same way in show cause. Unless it one show cause comes, it will be concluded by order. There is no time limit. Very recently, Mumbai High Court, in the case of Parle Products Limited, has quashed one of these things and it has slapped to the government that show cause notice was not adjudicated for as long as 9 years. Very recent decision of Parle product was there. If you are reading newspaper or any this thing, in the month of December only it was, Mumbai High Court stated that for 9 years, government has not adjudicated the show cause notice. The client, Parle product has approached to the High Court and it has said this show cause notice, no demand will not be recovered. So 9 years is the time for Parle. There's a one decision in the old regime where the courts have said that the plea was there before High Court that show cause notice was not heard for 7 years. Unfortunately, in that case, the Mumbai High Court has held that 7 years is still a reasonable period for adjudicating. So there are two contrary decisions. Parle product is very recent. That 7 years was a bit old decision. I don't recollect the name. So, but in your case, 7 months. So 7 months, to sir, rest assured. Itna jaldi to I think a baby also doesn't get born, na sir.
Achha, so last one. The client not registered under service tax, now temporary registration received from department along with payment of tax. Are return also to be filed?
Temporary registration, you got it now, fine. If you ask me from the statute point of view, you are now registered assessee. And every registered assessee section is very clear as to file the returns. Okay, that is one. So if you are not filing, it's a violation to that extent. And if you file the return, it will be late for sure, and you will be liable for the 20,000 penalty. Whether you file or you don't file, department can very well levy the penalty of late fee, 20,000. As a practical friend, I will put it this way. You should file the returns. So in this case, whether it is belated or no, forget it. You must file. So that what happened, no? At least returns is a disclosure from the assessee to the department about his tax liability and taxable value, etc. under service tax. So what happened, no? Whatever show cause is coming now, adjudication FSR happening, and over a period, if matter doesn't settle at ground level, and if it goes to the tribunal or further level, then you will have one very positive point in your favor that you have filed a return. Although it is filed lately, but you have filed. So department has got information available with them. Okay. They cannot say you are not provided this, you are not provided. At least that is being given. So sir, I will advise in this case, you should file the return. We are always filing the return for all of our client and we advise them. Of course, client has to take the decision if they don't want, because it doesn't save anything. No? Your late fee to otherwise be applicable. Alpesh?
Yes, sir.
Any
that's it. That's it, sir.
Thank you
very much, sir. Yeah. Before, sir, handing over, I just request my co-committee member, Sneha, to give a hearty vote of thanks to her.
Alpesh, sir. I will only take 1 minute before you present my apology. I think just 1 or 2 minutes, bear with me.
Yes, sir.
This service tax, the topic and the important at right time you selected, this is very, very important, because right now only up to March 15, the period has become time barred. The service tax was there up to June 17. Okay. So you have 15, 16, 16, 17 and the first quarter of 17. So almost you can say roughly we have 27 or maybe a 21 months period is still not time barred. Okay. And this process is not going to end over here. it will continue for next 1.5 years or so minimum, for the reason that the while speaking to a few of the executives in the department, I came to know that there are many defaulters they could able to locate by this drive of data matching, data mining, connecting with income tax data and service tax data, capturing from VAT office, etc., etc. So it is generating revenue to them. Of course, in the process, it may be possible that out of 10 showcos, 1, 2, or 3 are the one where they are getting revenue and other 7 are genuine people facing the harassments. But within the circumstances currently, like pandemic, you are also working from home, you have limited access of staff, records, or clients, as the case may be. Department is also sailing in the same boat. I am not protecting either you or department. And they have limitations of time plus targets of revenue, and they are in the process finding the leakages of revenue. So if you are a bona fide, genuine, and you have paid all the taxes, of course, onus will be upon you to prove with a documentary evidence and justify and show cause. But one should not get frustrated, etc. It's a cost to client, I know. But that is going to be there in every economy in this situation, because there are black ships, no? And government got the revenue. So they will try to invoke such kind of thing in the time to come. In my view, you will get many such notices in the month of March and April coming this year, because that is next year is getting time barred there. So you'll get plenty of notices. So please, rather complaining or getting frustrated what department is doing, I will try to put it this way, ki go by this, the pessimist is the only one who complains. The optimistic one, it feel like it will change. Next year, there will not be a target, no such notices. So optimist will think that things will change. But I think we should be a realistic. We should adjust our sale as it comes. Our job is to protect the client, defend the client. We are not here to encourage the evasion of taxes. But if bona fide tax is not payable, not liable, then it is our onus duty to prevent or protect our client from these harsh actions. Rather complaining, we should defend properly. That will be a great service. We will be able to give it to the client. And I think that is what is expected from a consultant also. So thank you very much to the study circle, all of you, for giving me this opportunity and a topic which is very right. Let me tell you, on the same topic, the other study circle, after going through your this thing, I mean to say initiative, has organized a similar talk on this part. This shows the gravity of the topic for the thanks to the study circle and each one of you for the giving me this chance to go through the provision. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. It was a pleasure to hear you, sir. And I request Sneha Varaya to take the vote of thanks, formally give the vote of thanks to the speaker. Sneha, over to you.
Thank you, Alpesh Bhai. Friends, it is not the strongest that survives, not the most intelligent, but the most responsive to change that survives. The members, we are united by a common thread and common mission of pursuing the learning. Friends, you all will agree that CA Rajiv Luthia covered his presentation in simple and lucid language. We are thankful to him for accepting our invitation and sharing his rich knowledge on the subject. I, on behalf of Mulund CACP Study Circle, present heartily vote of thanks. Thank you, Rajiv, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sneha. And members, friends, it was a pleasure to hear Rajiv, sir.
Thank you.
In spite of having 60-70 notices pending in his office, is working at 11 o'clock. He accepted our invitation for the meeting today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Alpesh. I am going to do the work. I am going to do the work. I am going to do the work. I am going to write the work.
Sir, your experience itself gives the work done.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Balaji, please end the meeting.